Okay, so it is 5 past 5, so I will introduce our virtual seminar for today. So it is entitled Where to Put Them, Burial Location in Middle Hellenistic to Late Roman Sagalassos in Southwest Anatolia. And we have two speakers with us today, both from KU Leuven, so Sam Cleymans and Bas Beaujean. Thank you so much for joining us. I'm sure I can say on behalf of all of our audience how excited we are to learn more about Sagalassos. So thank you so much. I will hand over to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, and thank you for the very nice introduction, and also our thanks to Nisha and to the British Institute at Ankara for hosting this seminar and for inviting us. So we're very pleased to present this research that we published in a paper in Anatolian Studies, and we're very pleased to introduce it here. So the presentation will be about the location of burial at Sagalassos from Middle Hellenistic to late Roman times. And before we start off with the case study, a very short theoretical note. So looking at funerary landscapes and where people buried their dead is something archaeologists have looked into before. And in fact, one of the first to do so was Arthur Sachs, who was fully working in a new archaeology theoretical framework. And in fact, he wanted mostly to test some hypotheses on burial culture, on funerary culture. And one of them was looking in for what reason people were buried at a specific location. And his hypothesis was that by burying people close to or on certain lands, that people could claim those lands and thus also claim the resources that were located there. Lynn Goldstein, working in the same theoretical framework, included the aspect of multidimensionality and multiscalarity in this research, but their research and their hypothesis were highly criticized by contextual archaeologists like Douglas Charles and Mike Parker Pearson, who mostly wanted to emphasize the cultural and symbolic meaning of burial location. And throughout the last couple of decades, archaeologists have applied funerary landscapes or the concept of funerary landscapes on many different case studies, but most of those case studies are prehistoric or Bronze Age. Whereas classical archaeology lags a bit behind. So there are some case studies which are mostly dealing with very specific phenomena in classical archaeology, such as Gräberstrasses, so those streets of the dead like the Via Appia, which are really flanked by tombs. And on the other hand, for example, extramural burials, which in Roman times were the norm. There are some studies which focused more on funerary landscapes, such as the two books that are presented on this slide.
So I will be taking over for a little bit, discussing basically the concept of deathscapes really quickly. So quite a mouthful, deathscapes are re-emergent spaces that predominantly facilitate and are in turn impacted by group-specific sequences of funerary and commemorative practices. So structurally, recurrent mortuary and non-mortuary practices unfold traces upon each other, gradually creating landscapes of the dead characteristic for a community. Herein, the pre-existing funerary phenomena play an important role as they provide affordances for groups to link past, present, and future through comparable funerary and commemorative activities as their ancestors. In addition, deathscapes are also linked to the world of the living in various ways. The dynamic nature of the concept allowed us to approach burial location from various methodologically separated aspects. And in our article, Sam and I focused on four of such aspects. Firstly, the dynamic boundaries, which are reconfigured by urban and funerary activities. So we actually archaeologically focused on urban and funerary data sets and how these related to each other. And this allows us to discuss how these relations inform the choice of burial location. Secondly, landscaping practices, which include terrain-related modifications, but also natural and anthropogenic features, which are integral to community-specific deathscapes. Once more, this allows us to determine what the impact of landscaping practices and pre-existing features were on burial location choice at Sagalassos. Third, visibility or the potential of funerary monuments to be noticed by those who do not use them for funerary and commemorative purposes. Here, we mainly use GIS-based analyses to determine the role of visibility in the choice of burial location. And finally, there's accessibility, which includes how reachable a sepulcher was, as well as how one could access the tomb. This is often linked to ritual space, as well as wider social issues like privacy, hygiene, and looting. In addition to discussing these spatial aspects, we also included other funerary datasets which impact deathscapes like gravecrypts. Finally, we will shortly discuss how our analyses of Sagalassos' deathscapes relates to our current knowledge of contemporary urban development.
And now we can start off with case study. So our case study is the ancient site of Sagalassos. And I'll quickly introduce Sagalassos to you. So Sagalassos is located in southwestern Anatolia in the historical region of Pisidia. And it was inhabited from the 5th century BC until the 13th century AD with its heydays in Roman imperial times. For the past 32 years, the Sagalassos project based at KU Leuven over here in Belgium has been excavating and studying the site and its hinterlands. And one of those aspects that Sagalassos project studied and still is studying are the necropoleis of Sagalassos. And this map is actually showing which data we have available for those necropoleis. So several sites in the eastern necropolis, those that are indicated with the site code, so it's an alphanumeric sign next to it, those were excavated. And the other ones are funerary monuments or burial containers that are still visible at the surface and were discovered during surveys. And one of the things that, thanks to those excavations and those surveys and the statistic features of those monuments and burial containers, it made it possible to date when certain grave types were in use. So this is a summary of all those grave types and when they were used at Sagalassos. And it helps us to indicate which period we're discussing. So today we'll do a chronological overview of how the spatial aspects of burial practices at Sagalassos evolved. And we'll start in Hellenistic times. And as you can see, in Hellenistic times, there were only a few ways of burial. The most common one were those Hellenistic cremation urns. So in fact, it were in from middle Hellenistic times onwards, it were very simple containers, ceramic containers that were reused as urns and which were covered by lids that consisted of reused cups, bowls, plates, and so on. Those, of course, don't really have much of a spatial impact. They're not very visible. They were just placed on the ground. So they didn't have much effect on the landscape. They didn't really change the landscape. And this changed in late Hellenistic times, probably quite late in Hellenistic times, so very close to Roman imperial times, and two main ways of burial that had a very spatial impact were on the one hand, on your left, the rectangular osteotheci, so rectangular burial containers used for cremations, which were highly decorated, as you can see in many cases. The other one is an excavated niskos or P-shaped monument, so to your right. And these were mostly used either as funerary altars or as a location that housed the rectangular osteotheca. Those heterospatial impacts, so when we're plotting those on a map, we see that most of those above ground visible niskoi and rectangular osteotheci were mostly clustering around the main entrance space to Sagalassos. Some of them were later reused in the city center, those indicated in blue. But very important is that all of those osteotheci and funerary monuments were located outside of town. So it seemed that already in Hellenistic times, the intramural burials were excluded or not allowed. Fascinating is that even in the areas where the Roman living quarters were located, so those areas in with the blue shading, that there are almost none Hellenistic burials or funerary monuments are located. So it seems that either the Hellenistic inhabitants of Sagalassos were already taking into account that those flatter areas around Sagalassos would be taken up by the city when it was expanding, or the funerary monuments over there were destructed or dismantled or removed when those living quarters came into existence. The only few funerary monuments that are located nowadays within those living areas are a couple of osteotheci which are flanking that road. So it seems that indeed those living quarters were growing and were taking up or incorporating parts of the necropolis. Nevertheless, it seems that there indeed was some sort of ban on intramural burials. Now, looking into visibility, we already noticed that many or almost all of those funerary phenomena were located or clustered around the entrance ways, so at very visible locations. And when looking to the maps on your left, you see that especially the front side of the osteotheci, those sides that were facing the entrance ways, those were highly decorated. The decoration was more varied, more elaborated than on the back sides, where there is always the same sort of iconography. Then the one excavated niskos tomb, when doing a viewshed analysis using GIS, you can see that it was located at the higher slopes of the East Necropolis and specifically at a location which was highly visible from the main entrance space, although it was further removed from it. And considering accessibility, from the rest of Pisidia and other parts of Asia Minor, we know that in Hellenistic times, very often burial plots were walled, had an enclosure around them, but this is completely absent for Hellenistic Sagalassos. So we have no indications of any enclosures. But of course, accessibility is also hampered by the location of those funerary phenomena, because they're often located on steeper slopes in the necropolis surrounding Sagalassos. So that is hampering accessibility as well.
As Song has discussed the data sets, I will do a quick discussion of why these burial locations were picked. So as our early and middle Hellenistic data sets are virtually non-existent, we have little insight into how a separation between the living and dead developed at Sagalassos. At nearby late 5th to late 3rd century BCE Düzentepe, there is possible evidence for intramural burials, perhaps even in relation to dwelling units. However, these contexts are poorly understood. Only in late Hellenistic times, likely between 150 and 100 BCE, do we obtain insight into funerary and commemorative practices at Sagalassos itself. Based on our current understanding of the late Hellenistic town, the deathscapes they configured were clearly separated from living areas. The processes behind these possible changes thus remain unknown, but a gradual shift, which we will expand upon later when we focus on the city, to a more outwards-looking community is likely part of it. So how did late Hellenistic groups pick a spot to bury their cinerary urns? First of all, while the location of site F is not extremely close to the nearest living area, and you can see it in the upper right corner in the rectangular yellow square, and possible living areas are situated in the central yellow rectangular square and the green dot and triangles, it was also not very far away. Furthermore, the plateau east of the possible town center offered plenty of pine wood, and there was ample space to build a pyre. As discussed, the former agricultural terraces against the mountainside provided a location which did not obstruct possible activities occurring at the center of the plateau, where also an entranceway was located. In addition, the western winds would blow the smoke away from the living areas. Once a spot was picked and became a preferred location for group burials, establishing relations with ancestors would have ensured that this burial ground expanded. For these cinerary urns, the terrain was not manipulated to increase visibility, and there are also no indications for other prerequisites, all of which suggests that deathscapes remained an intra-communal affair. This changed with the emergence of the rectangular ostotheci, where we focus on the modification of the southern necropolis. This deathscape was already being established by comparable cinerary urns. As such, the ostotheci did provide continuity with pre-existing funerary practices. Almost all ostotheci are situated in close proximity to an unpaved road, which became particularly active in the late 1st century BCE. Positioned on modified promontories, these funerary phenomena were meant to be seen. Because these were the first above-ground funerary phenomena, the choice of location was entirely up to the groups involved, and no enclosures to ensure enough ritual space were needed yet. So another question is why the area around Alexander's Hill, the conspicuous landmark south of the town, which you can see indicated by the blue arrow. In comparison to the other entranceways, this road was only beginning to develop in the first century BCE, and there were plenty of hills, road-adjacent areas, in other locations. Here, the real and or imagined associations of local groups of this hill with a distant battle in Bolivar and Alexander, and or the visibility of the hill from the urban center are possible explanations. For Sagalassos, the rectangular and possibly V-shaped ostotheci, sometimes placed on Nyskoi, were the first durable above-ground funerary phenomena and pioneered a fundamental shift to funerary display based on containers and structures. That they proliferate in pre-existing deathscapes, possibly with a deeper historical meaning, as well as during a time period when there was increasing social volatility, shows that groups used elements of continuity with preceding practices to attempt this gambit. For example, the heavy ostotheci could not be used to collect the cremains at the pyre site. As such, a ceramic urn was possibly still required to transport these remains.
So let's move to Roman imperial times. And when looking at the funerary or the grave types that were used, you see that there's like a real boom in variation. And this is partly due to the fact that cremation and inhumation practices are coinciding at this moment. So looking at the different grave types, those from Hellenistic times were still in use. So people still used rectangular ostotheci, still used cremation urns, and so on. But some new types emerged, like the acrosphoria, so in your top left corner, so niches that are cut in rock faces which are meant for cremation burials. Then top center, there's a vase-shaped osteotheca. And then the inhumation grave types are on your top right. This is one of the excavated temple tombs. Bottom left is a chamber tomb, a vaulted chamber tomb. Bottom center is individual vaulted tombs, and bottom right are some sarcophagi. When looking at the location of the Roman imperial necropolis, we see that they entirely encircle Sagalassos. So all around Sagalassos, we now have necropolis, and again, they mostly cluster around those important entrance ways. And there it is very interesting to see that, that many of those locations seem to overlap with the artisanal quarters. So for example, in your top right, there's the eastern suburbs of Sagalassos, the eastern suburbium, where the production of the local tableware, Sagalassos red slipware, is happening from early Roman imperial times onwards. And from that location, we also have several funerary monuments. Yet, when we plotted the exact location of all of those Roman funerary phenomena and made a heat map of it, and also plotted all the kilns in the eastern suburbium and made a heat map of that, it appeared that they were not really overlapping, but that the necropolis only started at the edges of the eastern suburbium. And over the years, some of the sites on the border between suburbium and the necropolis were excavated. So for example, on your left, you see a plan of site PQ1, which in early Roman imperial times was a potter's workshop, as you can see on your left. And in the second century AD, it was partly dismantled to build a temple tomb. On your right, you can see some terraces at the north of eastern suburbium or the eastern necropolis. And over here, the trench to the south was where the Hellenistic cremation urns were found. So it used to be a burial plot, but in Roman imperial times, a potter's quarter was built, which disturbed the Hellenistic context. At that location, ceramic production continued, but the terraces higher to the north on the higher slopes remained funerary terraces. And in fact, in Roman imperial times, we see that those entranceways keep on playing a very important role and even grow more important. Because as a matter of fact, all the way down into the valley, to the south of Sagalassos, we see that along the entranceway, there's some very large temple tombs were being built. So for example, the one, the top one, was excavated 2 years ago by Bas, and it belongs to the most important benefactor of Sagalassos. So when looking at those necropolis around Sagalassos and all the burial monuments and burial containers that are situated into it, again, it seems that those were only extra urban, so there was it wasn't allowed to bury people within town. And in Roman imperial times, there was even an official ban on intramural burials. So it seemed that Roman legislation on this ban made it to Sagalassos, and that Sagalassians were following it. There's only one, there's only one phenomenon in Asia Minor and Greece, which is known that allows intramural burials, and those are so-called hevoa, so large burial monuments, which were situated in town for very well-deserving citizens. And also at Sagalassos we have one, the Northwest Hegelon. But in the Northwest Hegelon, we don't have any indications of burial. So it seems that it was used as a cenotaph, so a burial monument without an actual grave in it. And then one very specific type of burial, which is important to mention, are those archaeosolia. So we see that in Roman imperial times, at a certain moment, the very steep cliffs north of Sagalassos are being used as necropoleis as well. And there, those archaeosolia are cut in the rock face, and I'm quite sure that Bas will explain why that is. Then when looking into landscaping, we see that from in Hellenistic times, there was barely any landscaping. There's just one indication of a surface that was flatted to put an osteotheke on it. But in Roman imperial times, we see that there are very large landscaping interventions happening at Sagalassos. And one great example is a burial compound in the east of the eastern necropolis, where large portions of the rock outcrop were cut away in order to create a terrace where the burial plot was oriented. And in fact, the rock face was cut up till a height or a depth of 4 meters. When looking into visibility, you can already see that there's this clustering of funerary monuments and burial containers around the entranceways. And when we then look at the distance of something about 40 meters around those entranceways, you can see that the majority of those funerary monuments are actually located within that area. So around 70% of all funerary monuments are in close proximity to the entrance space. And further on, you can see this cumulative view shed, which is not from the funerary monuments, but from people on the entrance space. And then you can see that even those funerary monuments that are quite far removed from the entrance space, that they are mostly oriented or placed in very visible locations. Also for the excavated monuments, it's clear that they're highly visible from the entrance ways and that their face, their facade is oriented towards those entrance ways. Although in many cases, the orientation of the landscape is slightly different. So they actually slightly tilted or moved those monuments to actually face the entrance ways. And then concerning accessibility, in Hellenistic times, we didn't have any indications for walls or enclosures. And in Roman imperial times, we have many. So for many of the sarcophagi, we know that they are in an enclosure. But in many cases, like this burial plot in the East Necropolis, you see very high walls that are fully encircling this plot. And as indicated by this part of a threshold, there was also a gate or a door to enter the burial plot. And the same is true for this temple tomb. So it's also walled by an enclosure wall. It's fully encircled by this wall, which could only be, the enclosure could only be entered through door or gate And also the threshold of the temple tomb itself indicates that it could be closed off by a door. So the accessibility is clearly hampered in Roman imperial times.
So like for the Hellenistic times, I'll also do a short discussion of several aspects, including burial location, but also how the deathscapes changed for the Roman imperial period. First of all, like rectangular ossitheca linked themselves within pre-existing deathscapes, so that later above-ground funerary phenomena relate to these ossitheca. This process of collocation is based on new monuments establishing relations with older funerary assemblages, in part impacting their configuration of monumentalities. In such multi-type clustering novelties, like the V-shaped ossitheca, stood out, more conspicuously expressing group differences while still integrating in the wider deathscapes. It is in this period, the late 1st century BCE, early 1st century CE, that the location of most necropoleis of Sagalassos was firmly established and would continue to determine most burial locations until the late 4th to early 5th century CE. Regarding inhumation, from approximately 150 BC to 50 CE, cremation was the only manner of processing the dead at Sagalassos. The first indications of inhumation, as discussed by some, emerged in the second half of the first century CE in the form of two vaulted chamber tombs. In terms of burial location, there is not much of a distinction as they are firmly situated within the eastern necropolis. However, these structures do represent different dynamics. First of all, doors were needed to shield the decaying dead, often placed in wooden coffins and or shrouds, or possibly temporarily let out on platforms. Secondly, the addition of an enclosure in times when the pressure on suitable lots was not yet at its apex, suggests a need for privacy during the associated activities. This stands in contrast to most above-ground funerary phenomena. Furthermore, the tomb's layout also suggests a secondary treatment of the remains at site D, at least. Taken together, we seem to be dealing with groups which treated their dead in distinct ways, focusing much more on in-group cohesion through practices than on visibility in interring their dead. Then we move on to the late 1st and 2nd century CE. And while for most of the 1st century CE, funerary phenomena remained relatively conservative in terms of funerary types, this changed from the 2nd century onwards. Firstly, the V-shaped ossitheca disappeared, while sarcophagi and temple tombs appeared and would come to proliferate during the 2nd to early 3rd century CE. This was also accompanied by the introduction of the epigraphic habit into funerary activities approximately 150 to 100 years after it was used in the production of honorific assemblages. Furthermore, a new decorative repertoire can also be linked to the sarcophagi, which partially contrasted with that of the older but also contemporary ossitheca. A last above-ground phenomenon concerns the archaeolia. For all of these phenomena, the location is based on pre-existing funerary monuments and often linked to attempts at creating more visibility or attract interest through architectural or decorative elaboration. Prominence based on associations with pre-existing funerary monuments usually trumped visibility at all costs, as some promontories where no clusters of funerary monuments existed remained empty. Fundamentally, these phenomena were all rooted in comparable dynamics as the rectangular ossitheca, with temple tombs increasingly playing the role Niceboy once did. In addition to above-ground funerary phenomena, we also observe groups preferring privacy over visibility before the increase in monument-related skepticism, which we will discuss later on. In a way, these burial grounds follow the trend of the vaulted chamber tombs, opting for a more private, obscured space for commemoration. Here, examples are the vaulted tombs for single interment found at site F and PQ4. These type of graves are likely more common than often assumed, a result of the archaeological reality that surveys are less costly than excavating tombs. This shows that there were also quite a few groups which were focusing more on more than only visibility in picking a burial location, and that privacy and affordances for funerary and commemorative activities played important roles as well. Furthermore, the proliferation of funerary phenomena, the use of enclosures, the rise of inhumation, and an increase in artisanal and social activities in eastern suburbia led to pressure on desirable lots for funerary display. This was not only the case for funerary activities, but concerned the world of the living as well. As some discussed at several sites, we see how workshops became tombs and vice versa. Despite this lack of suitable lots, groups tried to ensure a delineation between the world of the living and the dead, demonstrating that this was still an important factor in picking locations for burials or above-ground funerary phenomena. While the worlds of the dead and living touched each other, they never seemed to have truly merged, as is argued for other Pisidian settlements. This lack of suitable space also created a new type of deathscape at Sagalassos, as the mountain wall was gradually transformed into a type of columbarium through orchestolia. Firstly, as the mountain wall could be used for little else, these lots were cheaper. Secondly, we also see a late 1st to early 2nd century CE social differentiation at Sagalassos, as more groups obtained the material and immaterial resources to engage in funerary display. This is also evidenced by some of the epitaphs of the archaeostolia, which belong to former slaves and individuals which do not use Roman names in contrast to sarcophagi. This opportunity for more groups to engage in funerary display likely had unintended consequences. While the other funerary phenomena did not collocate according to type, because of the link to the mountain wall, archaeostolia very much did. This meant that their materiality had a much higher potential to amplify their similarities vis-a-vis their differences during funerary and other activities. As archaeostolia were cheaper, were more difficult to access, the proximity resulted in crowding, limiting ritual space during commemorative festivals, and as they increasingly became the last bastion of cremation at Sagalassos, the practice of cremation became increasingly associated with groups of limited resources. We believe this added to the devaluation of cremation versus inhumation, and a hypothesis which we are currently developing further within wider Pisidia. And in addition, this process also turned the northern necropolis into a deathscape distinct, specific to a group. As such, while participation in above-ground funerary phenomena diversified, the choice of location was still very much limited by a group's resources. Some notable authors have also remarked that the integration of writing into social memory processes facilitates skepticism. While the integration of the epigraphic habit into funerary phenomena at Sagalassos did not result in such skepticism, it still played a role from the late 2nd to early 3rd century CE onwards. Increasingly, and also throughout Asia Minor, imprecations and fines were included in epitaphs, suggesting that trust in the efficacy of these monumental tombs was waning. Archaeologically, Sagalassos provides plenty of evidence of reuse and reusurpation, a phenomenon which is also known within Asia Minor. If these imprecations and fines turned out not to be effective, this would have further eroded confidence and lowered the social resilience of above-ground funerary phenomena to external stressors. As most funerary phenomena at Sagalassos were reconfigured by small families, these would have been particularly vulnerable when the bad times were coming.
And then we move to late Roman Sagalassos, and in fact, in the 3rd century or the middle of the 3rd century AD, we see an important shift in burial traditions. Because from that moment onwards, most of the monumental tombs and burial containers do disappear at Sagalassos, a phenomenon which is also observed elsewhere in Asia Minor. And we see that from that moment onwards, almost exclusively simple pit inhumations were used. So those very simple pit inhumations look like this. So just a coffin burial in the ground. But it's interesting to see where those inhumations happen, because in fact those still take place within the former Roman Imperial necropolis, and even within Roman Imperial burial plots. So it seems that families or groups in late Roman times preserve or take over all the existing burial monuments or burial plots and start burying their dead over there. And one very interesting case study is within this burial compound in the Eastern Necropolis, which we already saw a couple of times. And originally, along the north and the east walls of this burial compound, the original second century AD Roman Imperial vaulted tombs were arranged and used for interments. But from the fourth century AD onwards, we see that new groups start burying their dead in very simple pit burials. And thanks to DNA research, we have quite a good understanding that those new groups that are buried there were clustering their graves, and those clusters belonged to members of the same family. And more importantly, or another indication that we're dealing with family groups is that within those clusters where we see the same haplotypes and same genetic code appearing, is that also the grave goods assemblages are very, very similar.
And finally, we also discuss the results of this for burial location in regard to late Roman times. As Tom discussed, we see that the installation of above ground funerary containers and the construction of larger sepulchres stops at gradually comes to a halt during the 3rd century CE. That we are now dealing with pit inhumations, basically reusing pre-existing burial grounds without durable markers. What is notable here is that most, as some said, that most of the pre-existing funerary monuments and graves were respected. In fact, care was also taken to dig around them. An exception are funerary phenomena associated with cremation, parts of which are reused to fortify the pits or cover them. And whether these rectangular and V-shaped ossetecae were intentionally destroyed or not remains currently unknown. The choice of burial location in late Roman times was thus in part based on pre-existing phenomena, establishing relations with them, and continued to reaffirm the boundaries between the worlds of the living and dead, as done during the preceding 3 centuries. However, we do have a fundamental shift in that visibility was no longer a major factor, at least where the monuments and tombs were concerned. To be clear, while there is fundamental change, there is also plenty of evidence for continuity in funerary and commemorative practices, mainly based on the similarities between grave goods of the 2nd to early 3rd century CE burials and the late Roman burials. Last, as a significant part of the pit inhumations belong to the mid-4th century CE, and activity stopped in the late 4th to early 5th century CE, we see a more fundamental shift in burial locations gradually taking place during that time frame. Currently, the location of the early 5th to mid-6th century CE graves remain unknown, but they seem to have avoided the pagan necropolis, bringing an end to more than 4 centuries of deathscape formation. And now I will shortly discuss how we can see comparisons between developments at the urban center and the surrounding deathscapes. First, as discussed, our insight into early and middle Hellenistic Sagalassos is very much limited to the upper Agra area, which is the central rectangle that you can see. Here, rubble substructures from mud brick buildings have been found below the Agra. This is comparable to the architecture at nearby Duzen Tepe, which was abandoned during the late 3rd to early 2nd century BC. If our interpretation of the Duzen Tepe burial is correct, we can expect that similar customs existed at nearby Sagalassos. The sites are only separated by approximately 5 kilometers. As such, the worlds of the living and dead would be much more intertwined than the late Hellenistic times. As discussed, the limited urban and funerary data sets also suggest an inwards looking community with little interest in extra communal affairs. In late Hellenistic times, we see the introduction of ashlar masonry at Sagalassos and the first monumental buildings. The ability to carve stone did not immediately carry over to the deathscapes for another 100 to 150 years. As discussed, the deathscapes were reconfigured by cinerary urns installed at former agricultural terraces, already establishing a separation between the dead and the living. While late Hellenistic Sagalassos was gradually expanding its super-regional relations, the urban data stats still suggest a mostly inwards-looking community. And the funerary data sets also show no interest in sustained regional group differentiation. It is only towards the end of the late Hellenistic period, possibly during the dominion of Mark Antony or the early Roman imperial period, that we see the first durable above-ground funerary phenomena appear. The early Roman imperial period saw a major population increase, in part through the resettling of veterans of both sides of the conflict, as well as the forceful relocation of groups resisting imperial rule. Partially because of this social volatility, groups innovated to reestablish their continuation in the form of honorific assemblages, as well as above-ground funerary phenomena. Where the deathscapes differ from honorific culture is in terms of variability. Where honorific monuments rapidly proliferate, quickly become architecturally elaborated, and are integrated into larger structures, the Ossotheci remained conservative in design for the first century CE. This distinction can likely be explained by honorific monuments being more intensively engaged in local and supra-regional political relations, while funerary phenomena were predominantly local affair aimed at familial configuration. These developments also impacted the Hellenistic necropoleis, as the increase in population required more housing, new facilities, and more burial plots. A last link between the city and the deathscapes concerns the northwest heroine, which in design cites the rectangular ossotheci and their roof-shaped lids, including a shield on its posterior. Next, we will discuss a relation between the nymphaea and temple tombs. As funerary phenomena proliferated into the second and early third century CE, it became increasingly monumental. And here we can draw a parallel between the emergence of nymphaea and temple tombs. At the urban center from the late first century BCE onwards, most honorific monuments collocated on the agorae, which became the prominent locations for such phenomena. As the super elite became increasingly powerful, they found ways to differentiate themselves from other elite groups, first through building benefactions and later through nymphaea. While these architecturally elaborated water features fulfilled comparable functions to the pre-existing fountain houses, they also allowed the elite to displace their monuments with a setting including gods and emperors. Similarly, the temple tombs allowed the elite to place their sarcophagi within structures referencing the sacred places of the gods and increasing their monumentality vis-a-vis other funerary phenomena. Another parallel between honorific and funerary monuments is the increase in skepticism. Like as discussed for the funerary monument, this is also happening during building benefactions, but also for smaller honorific assemblages. And last, in the late third to early fourth century CE, we see also increasing reuse of building elements in the city center. And we also see the subdivision of larger structures into smaller workshop units. Lastly, there is convincing evidence at the urban center for Christian unrest, as this religion gradually transformed the dominant way of life. For instance, during the fourth century CE, we have the destruction of the Agora Gymnasium and the Neon Library, including evidence of iconoclasm and the transformation of the shrine to the goddess Tyche into a dynastic monument for predominantly Christian emperors. While we do not have any evidence for this late fourth, early fifth transition in terms of actual funerary datasets, we do have an absence, which exactly occurs at this moment. And this suggests that these changes also impacted the choice for burial location.
And we'll end it here because we saw that it's already quite turning late. So that was it. Many thanks for listening. And when there are any questions, please, we're happy to answer them.
Hi, Sam and Bas. Hello, everybody.
Hi.
Hello, if you can hear me. I'm very sorry to everyone for being a bit late, but I'm grateful for Charlotte for getting this started off. It does look like we've had some questions already, but before we embark on the questions which have been asked, I really did just want to say that actually I was going to say this at the start of the whole seminar, that one of the really exciting things for me about this paper was the way that you really pulled together the kind of the theoretical and the data crunching, the kind of the heavy practical and thinking really creatively about things. So this has been, it's been lovely to see some of the images in color and have you hear you speak about them. It's been brilliant. So, and I would encourage anyone who has not yet read the paper to download it from the website, and you can get more of the detail there. But as I said, we do already have a couple of questions coming in, so I'm not going to take up any time. First of all, Elizabeth is interested in the cenotaph, which you mentioned earlier. And she wonders, is there any indication of who this was for?
No. So for the Northwest Herald, we have not any indication. So there's no inscription of who was buried there or for who it was meant. So there's no one buried in it, but for who it was meant. It's possibly for one of the important benefactors of Sagalassos, but we don't have a name to who it was built.
That's a shame. No inscriptions and no literary sources.
Exactly.
Okay, well, we have another question from Jaehoon, who asks about grave goods. I don't know whether there's much data about this, but he does ask whether grave goods differ in variety when compared to grave forms, chronologically speaking.
They do. So for Hellenistic times, we don't have any grave goods. So I can't say much about Hellenistic grave goods assemblages. But when comparing the Roman Imperial to the late Roman grave goods assemblages, we see three important aspects. So first of all, they are much more varied in Roman Imperial times. Second, the quality of the of the grave goods that were given to the deceased was much higher. So we see a lot of objects in precious materials or objects that were specifically made to give with the deceased. And thirdly, there's the grave goods are much more gendered. So we see a broader variety in grave goods between males and females than we see in late Roman times.
Thank you. I think that's probably answered the question beautifully. We also, can I just ask a question which follows on from that? And that was something I was wondering about. When you had mentioned the inward-looking of these Hellenistic, the inward-looking perspective of Hellenistic burials, just wondering, what does that mean in terms of, does that mean in terms of grave goods, this sense of not being interested in imports, but focusing instead on things which are produced locally? Is that what you meant by inward-looking?
Not entirely. It's more that community itself, and this is also from the urban data sets at the time, including ceramics, that the amount of imports is much lower than in late Hellenistic times. But the community itself is not that interested again, not any group in super regional political relations or even regional political relations. They seem to be mostly focusing on basic subsistence strategies. And it seems that the context which we found, which of course has been disturbed by the later burials, these cinerary urns. And then next to it, there are more terraces, which and where we have found a lot of shirts, which also likely belong to destroyed cinerary urns. There is no evidence that they really, beyond possible, of course, larger, how do you call it, more elaborate practices that have not persisted in the archaeological record. They were not trying to differentiate themselves as groups vis-a-vis external groups. That's mostly what is meant.
Okay, right, that makes it clearer for me, thank you. There is a bit of an echo when I speak. I'm not sure whether it's coming from me or somebody else, but I will try not to speak too much in that case. Mary has a question about the orientation of the burials and the landscape, and I wonder if this is partly to do with, is the orientation structured by the landscape or is it imposed on the landscape?
So the orientation is partly also the orientation of the graves and the graves and the burial plots is partly following the landscape, but very often it's slightly off. So it's slightly more oriented towards the entranceways. So not exactly following the orientation of the landscape. So it seems that within the margins of what was possible or what the landscape allowed, they always wanted to face those entrance ways.
And in terms of orientation according to certain beliefs, we also see that they do try to do it, for example, at the PQ4 barrel compound in late Roman times. But as soon as the place becomes a bit stuffed, they just start cramming them in any other direction. So it's like first belief and then later it's practicality. And you see that throughout time, basically.
Yeah, that does make sense. Right, to go back to all these questions, Elizabeth has a second question. Says she believes that you said there's only one N-shaped monument. If yes, are you hopeful that you might discover more of this type? And are they any ideas why this is so rare?
Well, I didn't fully get the question, so I'm looking it up in the chat.
Do you mean the nice one?
Yes, it's sorry, it's not in the chat, it's in the Q&A.
Ah, okay.
Does she mean the nice one?
I'm not sure what she...
It's not an N-shaped monument, it's a pie-shaped monument. So it's an Iskos tomb. There are many, but there's only one excavated from Hellenistic times. So that's the one that we focused on because we have best indication of its orientation, of its size. But there are some others of which the remains are visible at the surface, but we don't have any indications of the exact orientation anymore.
And the main reason why they are not as frequent as temple tombs become in later times is also because, as discussed during the first century CE and the late first century BCE, funerary culture was a lot more conservative than it was later on. The elite did not really invest that much into it yet.
Fantastic. Margot also has a question asking about, she's got a very big question. It's perhaps one of the biggest questions is, why are there changes in funerary traditions? Is this to do with internal dynamics or external pressures?
Most likely a combination of the two. But I think Bessie is better suited to answer that question.
Yes, also we do have to emphasize this. Most of these changes are very gradual and we have tried, I don't know if it came through very well, but we tried to both focus on change and continuity. So if we focus first on the actual fundamental shift to above ground funerary culture, which we do believe occurred during the late first century BCE. One of the current hypotheses is because of an increase of more diverse social groups at Sagalassos and an increase in population, that groups attempted to re-establish their own continuation more durably within the deathscapes. That's one of the main reasons behind why above ground funerary culture gradually emerged at the time. This was not an immediate explosion. Once successful, other groups started doing this and started innovating in themselves. And then later on, when we turn to the other way around, when above ground funerary culture disappears, but also when honorific culture disappears, and we see a lack of construction for large public buildings for a long time, we are clearly dealing, and not only with internal stresses here, this is a widely known phenomenon throughout Asia Minor, and I think even beyond. So what we have tried to emphasize is that we already see skepticism and distrust in the social value of honorific and above ground funerary monuments, and that this lowered the social resilience to external stresses, and basically desire of groups to still invest in these quite costly things. And then when there came a range of external stresses, including possible disease, war, insecurity, inflation, that the family basis monuments emerged was vulnerable, and eventually these groups decided it was not worth it anymore. Because we have also stressed that other funerary and commemorative practices, they did continue at these sites. We have evidence for the PQ4 burial compound that during the time when no new containers were installed or phenomena were built, that there were still commemorative activities continuing there. So they probably shifted their interests maybe to, for example, processions, etc., those type of things, meals. So yes, it's a bit of both. It's internal, external. So it's a, and eventually, I think the most fundamental shift seems to occur in terms of burial location during the late 4th, early 5th century CE. But there we don't have the later Greeks. So.
Fantastic. Actually, well, let me carry on with the questions that we've actually got. David says, did you study or quantify the removal of stone and architectural elements from the post-funerary phases?
Yes, we have, and mostly closer to the village that is now located, or the town that is now located in the valley south of Sagalassos. So there, the last couple of years, several architectural surveys have taken place in order to document the architectural elements, mostly of funerary monuments or temple tombs that were located closer to the valley, and how they are now incorporated in the modern day houses. At Sagalassos itself, several mostly of stotechi have been found as building material in later buildings in the city center. So there we have mapped them as well.
Do you have a sense of how much we've lost as a percentage, or?
Oh, no, and it's very difficult to calculate it in the sense that at the moment, around 6% of the entire Sagalassos is excavated. We just don't have enough data to start guessing whatever or estimating how much is lost.
I guess it's one of these games, what do we not have? And actually this follows on very nicely to Richard's question, which is that given the size of the population and the duration of the settlement, your sample is pretty small. So he's asking about other forms of burial or bodily disposal.
I once calculated based on the burial density, so the amount of or the number of graves or skeletons found within the excavated burial sites. So based on that burial density, and then multiplying it by the entire surface of the necropolis of Sagalassos, it seems that within the necropolis of Sagalassos, all Roman imperial inhabitants of Sagalassos could have been buried. So it seems that the tossing over the wall and feeding to wild animals, if it occurred, it would be exceptions.
Murder.
Scandalous. Well, actually, that's quite interesting that, you know, potentially everybody is there to be found if we just had endless time and resources to.
Exactly. So if you would excavate the entire necropolis, we would probably find almost everyone.
Well, a lot of them have also been spoliated. So,
yes.
Looted and transformation at endures for a long time into the 3rd century CE, and there is a big blind spot because we have very little. We know it continues, but we have no actual remains beyond the end of the 1st century.
Yeah, and also for inhumations from the 6th century AD onwards, we see that also sarcophagi, vaulted chamber tombs, and so on are looted, and very often the skeletal remains are completely removed.
Would these have been looted in antiquity?
Yes. Part of them, yeah. So there's one sarcophagus which was looted and then covered by 6th century AD
debris from a stone quarry.
From a stone quarry. So there we know that before 6th century it was already looted.
Okay, that is interesting. I mean, dating looting is probably quite difficult. I have some more questions, actually, if no, nobody else seems to have any questions, which is great, because I can now ask. I was going to ask about the secondary burials. I mean, you were talking about, you know, the living interacting with the dead and maybe ramping up things like processions, and but you did talk in the episode about secondary burials, and I just wanted to hear a little bit more about what that might have.
The evidence is still quite limited, but what we do have at one of the vault chamber tombs, so those were the phenomena which emerged in the second half of the first century CE, and were enclosed already and had doors on them. In one of them, at the entrance, there is a higher area subdivided by three walls, and there's a lower area behind it, which we, one of the hypotheses is a charnel, so that bodies were first placed on the three platforms, that subsequently, when new people were interned, the remains were placed on the in the lower part, and then they collocated there themselves. That's the main evidence for that tomb. The problem is, of course, that this tomb was significantly disturbed during later activities. So currently, we need to find more comparable tombs, actually, to work this out. So that is the only tomb for where we have that, where there is some evidence for it.
No, that's super interesting. It does remind me of some things which are happening around the same time in Gordian, where there does seem to be this interest in exposing or partially exposing bodies, and there's some evidence for, is it excarnation when you cut off the, which just sounds horrible. But
that's also why we think these were similarly already closed off, and mm-hmm. They're a bit of an outlier in our funerary repertoire. So.
Fantastic. If there's no more questions, I'm just going to, you know, expose having you for a minute more and ask you about the visibility analysis that you did, which is something else I find extremely interesting. Now, so part of this is viewshed analysis using GIS, and I imagine some of it's just you both knowing the landscape extremely well. But I'm interested as well as in intervisibility. Do we have any intervisibility between the different necropolis sites, and intervisibility between necropolis sites and cult sites or other major monuments within the urban centre?
Well, in some cases, we have some indications for it. So, in fact, most of the monumental tombs that are located on the higher slopes of the Eastern Necropolis and on the slopes of Alexander's Hill, those are visible from almost all over town. So there is enormous intervisibility related to those graves, but of course it's only a minority of the entire necropolis. But there's one very interesting case study where when walking up via the eastern entrance way to Sagalassos, at that location, there's one specific sarcophagus, the first one that someone walking into Sagalassos would see. And at exactly that point is also the first location where the burial compounds in the Eastern Necropolis can be seen. So it might be coincidence, but it would be a very big coincidence that the sarcophagus is exactly placed at that location. So it's the orange dots most to the east.
Here, if you can see my arrow. The mouse pointer.
So that's
these two tombs.
Yes. And so there's intervisibility between the two, and it's the very first sarcophagus that someone entering Sagalassos would see.
Oh, who's buried there?
No idea. There is a tabula rasa, but it's not readable anymore.
No. Well, three cycles in the mountains are not very good.
No.
We're trying now to solve it through RTI, but that's the work is just beginning. So.
Okay, well, good luck. Hope it works. RTI. We're getting close to 4:15, which is the time that we usually stop. So I'm going to, especially since there are a couple of questions which I've neglected. So I wonder if we can, yes, there's an open access link to the article. Fine. That's in the chat. Perfectly. So please do go away and read this article. It really is worth reading in a bit of detail. The other thing which is in the chat that I would encourage all of you to have a quick look at is an invitation to join, to become a member of the British Institute of Ankara. We have our centenary year next year. So there are lots of events going on and we're going to be very, very active. So please consider joining us. But thank you to everyone who has joined us this evening. And thanks especially to Sam and Baz for being so patient and for rounding off this year so beautifully with a richness of different material from whole, you know, centuries and centuries and loads of things to think about. So thank you very, very much. It's been a lovely December seminar.
Very welcome and many thanks for the invitation. Yes. It was a pleasure. It's ours.
Yes. Hopefully everything is all right there.
Yeah, well, all right. I'm going to bid farewell to everybody now. Thank you very, very much. Have a good evening, everybody.